Hello friends, I am Ayantika and in this video I will be discussing about the evolutionary trend in Chlamydomonadaceae. Basically, the evolutionary trend in Chlamydomonas, various species of Chlamydomonas and its related species. So in case you haven't watched my previous videos about the overview of Chlamydomonas, its structure, its ecological economic importance, its reproductive strategy, I would request you to watch the videos of Chlamydomonas part 1 and part 2. Then come to this video, because without understanding that, though without watching those videos, you won't be able to understand this video. So let's start the video. Now before I start the main topic of evolutionary trend in Chlamydomonadaceae, I would like you to solve a small quiz. Blood red color formed at the bottom of dry rock pool or bird bath is due to which of the following organisms? One is the first option is Euglena sanguinea, then is the Encyclonema nordenskioidea, then is the Haematococcus pluvialis, Scotiella nivalis, or now which is called Chloromonas nivalis, and Raphidonema. If you know the answer, write it in the comment section, or otherwise I will be discussing it at the end of the video. Now, in under normal condition, that is when the climatic condition is quite suitable for a normal growth, that is during the growth period, the normal mode of reproduction is actually asexual reproduction, that is division by successive bipartition. And only during the entire growth period we can see this type of reproduction, that is the asexual reproduction. But as the climate changes and it the conditions needed for growth, it usually becomes very difficult to grow, that is the climatic condition are not conducive to growth, during that period, that is the end of the growing season, then only we can see that there is a sexual reproduction. So say for example in a temperate region, the entire from the spring to the whole summer period, it will be asexual reproduction, that is reproduction by successive bipartition of Chlamydomonas. But during the end of the growing season, that is the entire winter, and that is not the entire winter, that is the beginning of the winter, we can see this the sexual reproduction. So we see that this sexual reproduction, it is, you know, when the motile swarmers, the zoospores, we know that the zoospores, these are the zoospores. So the zoospores, usually they have a much larger size than the gametes. So the swarmers, both zoospores and gametes, they are both called swarmers. So zoospores are used during the asexual reproduction, and during the end of the season, much smaller sized swarmer, that is the gametes are formed. These are the gametes are formed. Now as we see that due to the small due to the difference in the size of the spore, naturally there will be lesser amount of nutrient inside these gametes. So it happens that this smaller sized gamete having low nutrient content in their body, they have lesser chance to survive the entire winter period. So as because these the small sized spores, that is the gametes, the small sized swarmers, they, due to their small size, due to their low nutrient ability, they are not able to produce entire organism on their own. But here the juice spore, this is the juice spores. They are able to form their each juice spore is able to form an entire individual. So this juice spores are formed during the period where there is abundant the growing condition is very good, and there is abundant nutrient in the environment, and also the chlorophytic Chlamydomonadaceae is actually chlorophyte, so it prepares their own food. So during the period of high light intensity, they generally produce this juice spores. But as the temperature decreases and light intensity decreases, so less amount of food produced, this smaller gametes are smaller swarma, that is the gametes, are produced. So these gametes, they have lesser amount of nutrient, and they do not have the ability to produce one individual on its own. So most of these smaller swarmers, that is the gametes, they perish. But by accidental fusion, the two cells, two swarmers, say for example two small swarmers, they accidentally gets entangled, and there is fusion, there is fusion, and zygote is formed. And once the zygote is formed, the zygote, they develop a thick wall around it to form the zygospore. The zygote has much more amount of nutrient than each of the individual swarmers. Each of the individual swarmers have much lesser amount of nutrient content. So by fusion, the nutrient content of the resultant cell is increased. Also, it secretes a wall around itself. This wall around itself, this secretion of the wall, it helps to tight the extreme cold dry condition. So this method of sexual reproduction, it happened accidentally, and whatever happened, it actually improved the chance of survival of the species in which it was first formed. Say for example, in this species Polytoma uvela, the swarmers, they have the same dimension. The swarmer, that is a zoospores, they have the same dimension as that of the vegetative cell, and they swim out a bit and then they produce an individual, or they directly produce the individual. But in this is a very primitive form. As the there is gradual evolution, as there is a gradual evolution from primitive to the more advanced form, these swarmers, the swarmers, they started reducing their size during the end of the growing season, and each smaller spores, which by themselves do not have any chance of survival, they accidentally, if they fuse, and this fusion, due to this fusion, the chance of survival increase, because amount of nutrient also increased, and the resultant product also had a thick spore, which helps it to enables the spore, that is a zygospore, to tide over very harsh condition. Thus, this is the origin of sex. Next evolutionary trend is next stage is anisogamy, where both the cell the gamete structure as well as the size is different, and also the functionally it is different. In oogamy, it is also difference in the shape and in the shape and functioning of the gametes are different. I am showing you, this is isogamy homothallic, this should be of equal size. This is isogamy homothallic, where the gametes, they are of equal size, equal shape, and chemically also equal. The next stage is isogamy heterothallic, where there is equal in shape and size but difference chemically. Next, more advanced stage is that there is unequal structure, that is one is much smaller than the other, and last is the oogamy, where the structure as well as the physical condition, physiological as well as chemical condition are also different. So we see that there is a gradual advancement. Here in these are the isogamy, where equal number of gametes are produced, but in anisogamy, what happens is that in the different type of cells are produced. We know that this is the macrogamete, this is the macrogamete, and this is the microgamete. So one cell produces four macrogamete, that is the female gamete, and one cell and another cell of Chlamydomonas, it produces 4 to 16 microgametes. Microgametes, and here a single cell produces one macrogamete, and another single cell produces again 4 to 16 microgamete. So here also we see there is bit of advancement from the both in the shape, the size, there is also advancement chemically, there is also advancement physiological functioning of the gamete. So this is the this is all about the evolution of sex. And next point, the next evolutionary stage is we can discuss is blastids, where we see that the stellate blastid is very primitive form, which is followed by cup-shaped blastids. Then again, cup-shaped blastid is replaced by very reticulate type of blastids. This is the very reticulate type of blastids, where the reticulate type of blastids is again the next advanced stage will be very small, discoid shaped, numerous blastids. So this is the advancement in the shape of the blastids in the Chlamydomonas daisy. Now evolution of the origin of evolutionary lines. Many primitive features are mostly the contractile vacuoles, presence of contractile vacuoles, and then again the presence of eye spot. Then we have a number of chloroplast. If it is a primitive, it will have single chloroplast, and if it is a very advanced form, it will have many numerous chloroplast. Also, the same applies for the contractile vacuoles. And the evolutionary line, we see that regarding this contractile vacuole, eye spot, chloroplast, and the type of cell division and the type of reproduction, we can see that Polyuma uvula, which has all these primitive characteristics. And in this Chlamydomonas also, there are many degree of transitional stages, that is from Chlamydomonas, Dibariena media, to gradual advancement in Reinhardi, Chlamydomonas Reinhardi, Chlamydomonas subugonum, then Chlamydomonas ugonum. There we see, and Chlamydomonas is actually much more, it is also a very primitive form, and from it appears as a primitive form from which many other lines like volvocine, chlorococcine, tetrasporine line has been obtained. Here we see that there is a gradual evolution from asexual to sexual stage, and in sexual also there is a gradual evolution from isogamy homothallic to isogamy heterothallic to an isogamy, finally ending with oogamy. And also we can see evolutionary trend in the chloroplast also. So these are the evolutionary trends that we can find in Chlamydomonadaceae. Now let's come to the obvious part. Blood red color formed at the bottom of the dried rock pool or any bird bath is due to which of the following? Here we see Euglena sanguinea. This is a red colored Euglena, but they are generally not found in the bottom of the rocky pool. They are actually they are found in the deep mineral rich or organic rich sediments. And then is the Encyclonema. Encyclonema, it is generally found in the snow region. And Encyclonema, along with option D, Sportiella nivalis, which is now called Chloromonas nivalis, and Raphidonema nivalis, they are all present in the snow, growing during the snow melt, and they appear to be green color during the snow melt. And during the winter season, when the condition is not conductive for growth, they stay as cyst form. And during this cyst form, winter cyst form stage, they appear colored. This color is mainly due to the accumulation of pigments in the vacuoles. These pigments are especially astaxanthin and many other UV protective pigments. They are helpful for UV protection in the polar and the alpine region. Why? Because though the climatic temperature is very low, but they do not have they actually receive direct sunlight because there is no such trees in the alpine region, so they receive direct sunlight and excess UV ray can damage it. So these pigments that are found in Encyclonema, Scotiola, Rapidonema, these three species of snow loving or that is cold adapted microalgae, all of which are chlorophytes, these algae, they have this coloration, vacuolar pigmentation. This pigment, they protect the algae from oxidative stress due to UV rays. So these are photoprotective pigments that are present in the vacuoles. And the third option, Haematococcus pluvialis, they are the algae that are found in water, and during the end of the growing season, they accumulate in the bottom of the pond. When the water has dried away, they accumulate at the bottom of the pond, and they have this coloration. The coloration is also the same reason as that of the snow algae. The Haematococcus pluvialis, this is an aquatic algae, and the resting stage is blood red colored due to the same pigment astaxanthin. And this astaxanthin containing cysts, they appear red, and they are present at the bottom of the sediment in any aquatic ecosystem where the water has dried at the end of the growing season. So the answer will be the option C, that is the Haematococcus pluvialis, because that is the only aquatic algae. The others are found in very high altitude, high latitude region, that is the in the polar and the alpine region, but this Haematococcus pluvialis found in the temperate region also, where we can get water throughout the summer, and the water either freezes or lost to evaporation, or mostly like this. The answer will be Haematococcus pluvialis. So with this, I come to the end of the video, that is the evolutionary trends in Chlamydomonadaceae. Hope you understand the video. If in any case you need me to explain a certain point in detail, or want me to make any new videos, you can also write me in the comment section. And I put the links of all the videos that I have been making so far in the description box. Thanks for watching the video. If you like the video, share it with your friends and do subscribe to get the latest updates of the videos that I am making. Thank you.